This is sailboat Freya, bound for Newfoundland. Over.
Roger, Freya. What is your present position?
25 miles west of Grand Bahama. Voyage should take about 15 days. Over.
Roger, Captain. We copy that. Good sailing. Coast Guard out.
I'm making a steady 10 knots through the Straits of Florida, but only half my speed is from the wind. Powered by the sun and the spin of the Earth itself, I'm riding a current which flows up the western Atlantic like a river in the ocean. Voyage began 12 days ago, 1,500 miles to the south, near the equator, where the cycle of winds and currents begins. As the sun heats the tropical ocean, hot, moist air rises off the water. Immense thunderheads form in a belt around the whole Earth. This is the zone of the doldrums. As clouds condense and rain falls, the surrounding air is heated more. Vertical gales blow through these hot towers, nearly to the edge of the stratosphere. Finally, the air flows away from the equator towards the poles as a thin, high-altitude wind. At the surface in the doldrums, winds are erratic. As hot air rises all around, I am becalmed. It took days sailing through tropical squalls and prolonged calms to reach the trade winds, the most constant winds on the planet. They blow from the northeast towards the equator to replace the heated air which rises in the doldrums. Blowing from Africa to the Caribbean, these winds carried the slave trade to the New World. Every wave and ripple pushed by the trades transfers energy from the air to the sea, causing a westward drift of the waters, the equatorial currents. When they reach the coast of Brazil, these wide, slow currents are deflected northwards. Much of this water flows through the Caribbean, across the Gulf of Mexico, and out through the Florida Straits to become the Gulfstream. Time-lapse satellite photography shows the dark blue current flowing northward over a period of several days. Thank you. For plankton adrift in the Gulf Stream, time passes with a different pulse. Commonest animals are gelatinous. Some species named salps form delicate colonies and chains several meters across. Here, a small colony is carried by one large individual. The tenophore is propelled by rows of iridescent cilia. The medusa, swimming with rhythmic contractions, preys on the tenophore. Salps feed by filtering minute organic particles from the water, which they pump through their body. For many organisms, swimming and feeding are the same motion. Despite the diversity of life, populations are small in the Gulf Stream. This is caused by a lack of nutrients and explains the incredible clarity of the water. For the gelatinous species, transparency is the best camouflage. And the most visible creatures are fast-moving predators. Here, off Cape Hatteras, infrared space photography colors the current magenta, showing that it is far hotter than the blue-colored water along the coast. 80 kilometers wide and nearly 3,000 meters deep, the stream forms the western boundary of a huge revolving gyre of water, the Sargasso Sea. This sea within a sea is named after the patches of sargassum weed which drift here, caught by the encircling currents. Buoyed up by its grape-like floats, this simple plant shelters 100 different animal species. At the bottom of the food chain, microscopic organisms encrust the weed with calcium deposits and fern-like colonies. A minute sea spider picks at a branch. This finger-sized fireworm browses on the microscopic creatures. Camouflaged like the weed, the sargassum fish can swallow animals its own size. Its fins have evolved into grasping hands. In a marine jungle, it is better to crawl than to swim. Living in the weed, the Leander shrimp has evolved lobster-like claws. At night, these clumsy swimmers may venture into the waters below, but fast-moving predators lie in wait. The most voracious sargassum creature is the portunus crab. It lies camouflaged in the weed, catching anything from small fish to microscopic anemones. Weak currents and variable winds over the Sargasso Sea push the rafts of weed into windrows, which drift into the Gulf Stream and are carried away to the north. In the open current, predator and prey need speed or shelter to survive. Hundreds of miles from their natural habitat, reef-dwelling fishes forage for plankton from the shelter of a piece of driftwood. Goose barnacles encrust an old bottle. Bonito are one of the fastest swimming fishes. To escape their attack, flying fish take to the air. With extraordinary powers of smell and an acute sense of underwater vibration, sharks are the ultimate hunters of the Gulf Stream. Sailing north, I leave the trade wind zone and enter the middle latitudes, where the prevailing winds are from the west.
NOAA Weather Radio, KRG-77, Cape Hatteras. Weather map features for the coastal area. A cold front extending from a low over central Canada will pass over the coast today. Squalls and thundershowers will intensify as the front moves offshore over the Gulf Stream.
Periodically, cold air masses from the north interrupt the flow of the warm west wind. As the front passes over the current, tropical heat and moisture flow into the atmosphere, and the clouds grow. Sometimes the turbulence is so intense the tornadic whirlwinds develop. These can reach down to the ocean surface as violent but slow-moving waterspouts. The heat of the Gulf Stream, pouring into the air here off the American coast, is transferred to the west wind, and this drives the weather systems that eventually warm the climate of Europe. Heat loss affects the flow of the current. Cooling makes the stream flow more swiftly. If I were to sail these waters in midwinter, when Arctic air from Canada breaks out across the northern Sargasso Sea, I would encounter sea smoke steaming off the water over a huge area. The heat put into the ocean at the equator pours into the atmosphere 6,000 kilometers to the north. And the cooled water of the current sinks down under the Sargasso Sea, pulling the Gulf Stream north as strongly as the trade winds are pushing it in the tropics. Like a river, the Gulf Stream flows most swiftly at its center. Northbound ships can gain an extra 100 miles each day they navigate in the axis of the current. In the spring, humpback whales migrate from their breeding grounds in the tropics. As they ride the current, the young grow the thick blubber they'll need when they enter the cold waters of the north. The outer edge of the current is marked by a distinct line where sargassum and debris collect. Mariners call this edge the North Wall. Crossing it, I pass from the hot tropical ocean into the cold, gray-green waters of the North Atlantic. On infrared photographs from space, a series of meanders is revealed along the North Wall. Over a period of days, huge loops of the stream can pinch off, forming closed rings 200 kilometers across. These warm rings drift for months in the cold water before fusing back into the current. Loops which pinch off to the south encircle cores of cold water. Creatures caught in a cold core, like this medusa with its attendant cleaning fish, will eventually perish as the core slowly mixes away into the warm Sargasso Sea. Sailing between the Gulf Stream and the coastline, I am passing over the vast sloping embankment that plunges from the continental shelf to the ocean floor. This is the slope water, cool and fertile. Migrant animals from near and far feed in these waters. Each night, small fish in endless shoals make a vertical migration of a few hundred meters to feed at the surface. squid also come up from the deep to feed. They descend again at dawn. Dolphins range the slope water and the current throughout the year. The most traveled migrant is the great shearwater, which nests in the South Atlantic, but each year flies 15,000 kilometers north to feed here. Summer weather on the slope water is changeable. A calm, then a gentle breeze, brings a dull haze across the sky. Ice crystals high in the air cause a halo to appear around the sun. The sea begins to roll with an uneasy, growing swell. 10 days ago, a storm began far to the south. A disturbance of squalls and thunderstorms formed deep in the tropics, where the trades and doldrums meet. The spin of the earth organized the system into a vortex of gales, hundreds of kilometers across.
Warning, Hurricane Celeste intensifying, moving westward north of the Bahamas, expected to accelerate northeast up the Gulfstream tomorrow. Maximum sustained winds near 110 knots, gusting to 130 knots.
Raging winds push great waves hundreds of miles out ahead of the advancing storm.
Shipping, 1400 hours. Hurricane Celeste imminent for sea area east of Sable Island. Moving northeast at 50 kilometers per hour with winds up to 200 kilometers per hour at storm center.
The hurricane feeds on the heat of the Gulf Stream as it roars up the east coast. But when it leaves the hot water, its energy source is cut off, and it diminishes to a gale over my location in the cold North Atlantic. Of the gale, the waves slowly subside. The warm air brought up from the tropics spreads over the cold water, bringing on a damp fog. Extending for hundreds of miles, fog hides the greatest hazard to navigation. Ice. Icebergs are carried here from Greenland in the cold Labrador Current. It was here, south of Newfoundland, that the Titanic hit a berg and sank. From Baffin Island, the Labrador Current flows south as far as Newfoundland, where it mixes into the slope water. Together, these fill the deep Atlantic with the dense cold water over which the lighter Sargasso Sea floats. One species ranges the whole Atlantic. The bluefin tuna spawns off Africa and travels the equatorial currents to the Caribbean. In the spring, they move up the Gulf Stream to feed in Canadian coastal waters. Fattened on herring and mackerel, they make a great migration back across the Atlantic in the autumn. Sunlight energizes the wind and sea, creating the turbulence in which life evolves. On the scale of the planet, patterns emerge. The cycle of the Gulf Stream, the vortex of the storm, the wind that fills my sail, and the wave that breaks on the shore.